Welcome to the Normative News at 9 with your team of crack reporters on top of every average story. And your host, Steve Corny.
Good evening and welcome to the Normative News, your news source for the average and everyday. I'm your host, Steve Corny. Today's top story, 52 school children were taken to school by means of a school bus. Following this story live on location is Doug Dustimer. Doug, tell us what you know.
Steve, I'm here in front of Vernon Hills High School and bus 459 has just pulled up. In a moment, we'll see some kids get off and walk into school and head to class.
Doug, thanks for following this story. We'll come back to you if there are any changes. And this just in, old lady Jones's kitty did not go into a tree, and the fire department was not called. And now to Kevin for sports. Kevin?
Thanks, Steve. Today, there was a pickup basketball game in the gym. No one really made any amazing plays. One source said, "We came out here to get some exercise, and we did." Well, how about that?
What if this was the news? Not very interesting, huh? It's true, none of us would watch the Normative News at 9 because we could see that stuff in our everyday life. The news is more flashy. It focuses on the extraordinary instead of the ordinary. We see these images and we are conditioned to seek out the negative or the extremely positive. It's just more interesting. Look at the screen in front of you. What do you see? How many said the white background? You're conditioned to see the exception of the red dot on the white background. If we all saw the white background, our Monday mornings might sound like this. All right, I have an amazing story about what happened this weekend. You'll never believe what Sally did. She spent all weekend at home doing her homework and babysitting for her little sister. Oh my gosh, really? So the stories that get around tend to focus on the extraordinary events in people's lives, not the normal, boring, everyday. So you might look at these posters and think,
that's ridiculous. I don't believe it. I know way more people that drink. Don't you? Look at that. These people are ridiculous. Those posters are just made up.
So that's why we're here today. So that you get to know these posters. So you believe the data on these posters. And so you know why these posters and this data matters to your everyday life. Here's Mr. Corny to give you some background on what these posters are and how we came up with the numbers.
If you've ever asked yourself, where did they get those numbers anyways, you're probably not alone. Here's how it goes. First class leaders passed out a survey to each student in attendance during the first class lesson. Because we know this survey covered a personal and sensitive topic, steps were taken to protect confidentiality. For example, teachers were asked to stay at their desks so as not to give the impression that they were looking over the shoulders of students as they answered the questions. Also, students were provided with a sheet of paper with which to cover their answers so other students couldn't see how they were answering the questions. Now, once they finished their surveys, students individually placed them in manila envelopes, which were sealed immediately.
The next step in the process was for Mrs. Pither to send the surveys to an outside agency. Before the data was analyzed, the surveys that were determined to be inaccurate due to inconsistent answers were removed. The remaining surveys were then analyzed, and those are the results you see on the posters today.
Now you know where the data on the posters came from. In order to help you believe the posters, we are going to answer some of the most common student criticism of the posters.
I don't believe the social norm posters because I think the school makes it all up.
The data that we get and that we put on the posters is not from any of us. We don't decide what the data is. We actually ask all the students and we get anonymous answers through our survey. I put them all in a box, don't look at any of them, and send them off to a university that compiles the data. So really, I don't have anything to do with it after the survey until the data comes back here.
I think students actually lied on the survey because they really didn't want to get in trouble.
Okay, the goal of the survey is not to catch anyone. We've never caught anyone. No one's ever gotten in trouble because of how they responded on the survey. We don't seek to catch kids in this survey, so our goal is not to catch kids. No one's been caught. In the future, no one will be caught because we're not looking to catch students. What we're looking for is honest answers so that we can form programs that are really useful and helpful to our students. We're not looking at individual data, so we're not going to pull out Sue's survey and say, oh, this is how Sue answered. We're looking at collective data. We're looking at the student body as a whole in an effort to design programs that are going to be effective for the entire student body. We never look at one survey in particular. We look at them as a whole.
I think it's not true because I know so many people that actually do it. Like more than 25% of the people I know do it. More than 50% of the people I know do it.
I think that people who have the assumption that everybody out there is using drugs and alcohol are the kinds of people that might be themselves hanging around those people and not realizing that the vast majority of students in the school don't. So they might want to check their friends and maybe just realize that that's who they're hanging out with.
I don't believe the posters, actually, because if people throw out the surveys, then a lot of the information's invalid on the posters, and it just doesn't count.
So yeah, like, if all the people who did drugs, like, filled out their surveys wrong, and then they threw them all out, and then it's invalid, all the data is skewed.
Excellent question. To answer that question, I've got plenty of numbers here from what we used last year in our surveys. Last year, 1,270 students took surveys. Of those, 91 were thrown out for inconsistencies. Some students chose to only answer less than 75% of the questions, so they were thrown out. Or maybe some doodling happened and they just didn't take it seriously. So that's 91 thrown out, which means 1,179 were the ones that we used to determine the data for all of the social norming posters. Now, the most recent poster had a stat that said 76% were non-users. That 76% came from 896 that said they didn't use, divided by the 1,179, to get the 76%. And the thought is on the question that that's not a believable number because what if all 91 actually used? Well, if we just made the assumption that 91 kids that we threw out for their surveys did use, all of them, 100% of them, not that that's the best assumption, but we're going to make that assumption for the sake of being conservative. That would mean we still have 896 non-users. But now we would divide by the entire 1,270. That will get us 71%. Less than the 76 for sure, but not by a great deal. And still enough to believe that nearly 3/4 of the students in the school are making correct, healthy decisions.
I don't believe in the social norms posters. I hear so many stories about people drinking and doing drugs over the weekend, even during the weekdays. It's ridiculous. What's wrong with you people?
I think that question really encapsulates the main message of this video, and that is that what we perceive to happen doesn't really always match what's actually going on. Not that we're saying that people don't talk about, you know, other things they did on the weekend, like how much time they spent doing homework or the movie that they may have seen with friends or whatever. But since those behaviors are normal, those stories generally aren't circulated that widely throughout the school. As opposed to the story of how there was a big party and everyone was getting drunk and getting high or whatever, that's the information that gets passed around the school. And so what happens is our perception of what happened over the weekend is a little distorted. We tend to think that the party was the only thing that happened, even though really there was a lot of more normal behavior going on as well. And when our perception doesn't match that reality, you know, numbers like this are really hard to believe.
Watch this video. It should shed some light on this whole concept.
How long has this been happening?
I don't know.
I just walked in. Has it been going on for a while?
No, it's just no. So. This guy just dropped the papers a couple minutes ago. About a minute ago,
yeah.
Not even.
Look at that radio here.
It's like everybody.
It's like everybody.
It's not everybody. Just look at how many people are moving. All we're trying to show is that phrases we commonly use like everybody was drunk, or everybody was wasted, or everybody's frozen are just not accurate. In fact, they're not even close, and the data proves it. It turns out that many more students are choosing to avoid drugs and alcohol altogether. So why do these posters matter to you? We want you to know what everybody is choosing to do. Now, it's up to you to make an informed and healthy decision.